When we were first planning this, there was, you know, hurricane after hurricane hitting Puerto Rico, hitting Texas, hitting, you know, all over the world. We were constantly seeing water shortage challenges.
Water is always going to be increasingly more scarce, and we're only going to have more climate-related disaster scenarios. And so we have to figure out how to produce clean water for people. And I genuinely think that it's going to work.
Water is life, and access to it will shape communities across the world. In 2019, the U.S. Department of Energy saw the challenge of providing potable water to remote, islanded, and disaster-impacted communities as a need for both water and clean energy innovation. And the opportunity was right off the coast.
I think seeing desalination at this scale will continue and be there'll be more of it in the future. There's so many areas of the world where this would be very beneficial. And I do think wave power desal will play a part in that.
Marine power desalination is still moderately new, and the Department of Energy saw the opportunity for advancement in this type of technology by looking smaller to develop compact, modular, and accessible devices that could produce drinking water for islanded, remote, or disaster-impacted communities.
You know, when we first set out to do this, one of our motivations was trying to attract new people, new organizations to both wave energy, but also show that wave power desalination is not just something that we write about in technical reports, but actually something that we could feasibly see.
We're trying to really spark an industry to try and get people thinking about this problem. And it's, you know, not just the desalination problem, but certainly the wave energy problem as a whole.
There's not really a community around this issue, so wanting to grow, just get a variety of people in there and really think about how to support people in trying to solve these difficult technical challenges.
To properly inspire this type of innovation, the Department of Energy's Water Power Technologies Office announced the Waves to Water Prize in 2019, a five-staged competition to encourage the development of those small, modular, cost-competitive wave power desalination systems. The prize format encouraged more diversity, fresh ideas, and fewer barriers to entry.
It's the best way that we can try to get, you know, interdisciplinary teams, new ideas, new concepts by recognizing the challenges of working with the federal government to support research and development. So I think it's ultimately a tool that is really effective at both proving out research, but also attracting new people to this space.
We had about, I think, 66 entrants in the first stage of the prize. And then, you know, as of course, over time, we've, you know, narrowed that down and got down to what is essentially the final four, which are, you know, four, I think, very fantastic teams who have put a lot of effort into this over the last 3 years and built very interesting technologies.
Those four teams reached the drink stage, where they had 180 days to build and ship their systems to Jeanette's Pier in Nags Head, North Carolina, to engage in pitch sessions, business ideas, device viewings, and above all, an open ocean test.
Instead of looking at models and simulations and just thinking about where wave energy might be 30, 40 years from now, really focusing in on, well, the technology, there is technology today, what can it do and how can it do it well? And part of the reason that we did it at the scale we did with the smaller systems is it enables us to do that without as much money being spent. We can do things faster, we can learn faster, and hopefully push the technology a little bit quicker.
And so all those things led us to choose these type of wave conditions we'll get here in the Outer Banks and to this particular competition format.
In April of 2022, the drink finale became reality as the four remaining teams and their devices came together at the Coastal Studies Institute.
I'm extremely proud of the fact that we have, you know, sitting in this room, we have five wave energy devices, you know, one that we built and four that other other groups have built. And, you know, prior to this, we really have never actually seen that many wave power desalination systems.
The first step for teams after arriving in Nags Head was to assemble their wave power desalination devices, which would be monitored and judged as a part of the competition. This not only readied their devices for a water deployment, it also showed what setup might look like for communities in need.
At its most simple, this is a series of generators that spin to produce electricity. and electricity drives a reverse osmosis desalination system. And so everything on this device is geared towards producing electricity. And you'll see things like cables and pulleys, which connect to a mooring or a seabed anchor. And that's what pulls on this bike chain, essentially, to spin a generator.
So this is, as I said, an attenuator, which essentially is a hinged long thing that sits on the surface of the water like a small boat. And it oscillates and hinges. And that hinging action pumps a cylinder, which generates high pressure. And that high pressure seawater is then forced through an RO unit. And what's special about an attenuator is that you can tune them to a wave condition a lot more than a point absorber, so that they resonate on the surface of the water as opposed to just bobbing. You can create them in such a way for a particular location at a particular time of year or whatever, where they really outperform point absorbers.
So this is our snowflake buoy. It's a wave energy converter. And so it builds pressure using the wave energy, using an anchor and a rope tied to the bottom. So it goes up and down the waves, it builds up energy, builds up pressure with that water, with that salt water. And it brings it back to the process plant, which is our desalination unit, where this pressure pushes the water through reverse osmosis membranes. And so in the end, we have a desalinated water that comes out of those membranes.
So what we have here is the wave actuated tethered emergency response buoyant reverse osmosis system. And it is a direct drive wave heave to reverse osmosis clean water producer. So our concept and the way we ran with it was 3 to 4 strong men or women can pick this device up out of the crate, use the crate as a rubble or ballast anchor, take it out with a dinghy, sink the anchor, tether the buoy onto it, and everything is enclosed, start producing water.
Even with $1 million in cash prizes at stake and years of hard work on the line, the atmosphere amongst the teams was one of unity.
Every single person we've come across over the past 2 years, whether it be the other teams in the group meetings, the outstanding people at NREL and CSI and DOE, we have had nothing but positive experiences. So we lend helping hands to the other teams that we're directly competing against, and they've lended hands to us. I think everyone here is with the impassioned spirit of wanting every project here to succeed, because that's what's going to make an impact on the community.
And we do all have a common goal, right? We're all trying to solve the same problem, just different methods, and very supportive of each other.
Once these things are deployed, we're all competing against the ocean. And the ocean's got a pretty good track record of winning. So I would, I'd like to see all the teams do well out there. I'd like to see 4 devices that survive and then produce water, and then we'll see how the metrics fall out from there.
While each device has its differences, they all went to Nags Head for the same reason: to put their devices to the real test in the open ocean.
The conditions here are awesome. It's great as far as the logistics for getting the devices in, but it is still a very energetic and dynamic environment that's gonna be exciting to see how the devices play out.
To see the aggression the ocean can throw at you is both daunting, but also exciting, because we're gonna use that same energy it throws at us to produce that clean drinking water, and that's fun.
The open ocean deployment was a success, as each device produced desalinated water in some harsh ocean conditions.
I don't think that we could have asked for a better result of actually having potable water produced at all. I mean, when we first started out on this prize, you know, the whole theory and philosophy was that wave energy could produce potable water. But it was more of a hypothesis than anything else. And so seeing not just one, not two, not three, but all 4 actually produce water was an incredible accomplishment for our team.
People were really excited to see the devices on their moorings in the water, and it was a huge accomplishment, I think, for everybody to have put 4 wave energy converters in the ocean in one day. And so as a team, I think we felt a great sense of accomplishment for having succeeded in doing that.
But this accomplishment didn't come without challenges.
The wind picked up to about 30 knots, and I think we had seas in excess of about 1.2 meters or something like that in very short periods. So we definitely had breaking waves on the bar where the devices were deployed. We don't know exactly what happened with all of the devices. You know, it was a learning experience. I think some of the devices perhaps got tangled on their moorings and snapped the line. One of them actually moved the chain pile mooring that it was on, and so there was no damage done to the mooring itself. It just actually moved the mooring. And I think some of the challenges that we saw with that are that these are devices in a breaking wave environment. And to my knowledge, there isn't a model that is available to describe the forces that are going that the devices will undertake in an environment like that. It's very nonlinear, and so it's very complicated. And so that's why we do things in the ocean, so we can learn from these things and move forward.
The ocean is a really tough environment to work. And I would rather have systems, you know, fail, for lack of a better term, on their moorings when it's small systems that's part of a price competition. You know, these are lessons we need to learn if we're actually going to operate systems in the long term. And what it meant for us too is it also gave us a whole new set of research questions that we will have to address. What does it mean to put systems in a near shore environment? What does it mean to understand the loads on mooring systems, which might seem like a very boring technical things, but they're actually going to be really important if we want to see the commercial success of these systems.
Even with the shortened test period, enough information was collected to announce the winners of the Waves to Water Prize. Onika Technologies took home the grand prize of $500,000 and was also awarded $125,000 for producing the most water. They also received $80,000 for having the simplest assembly and another $24,000 in the deployment and retrieval category. The Water Bros team was awarded $125,000 for creating the lightest device. They also received $17,000 in the assembly category and $36,000 for deployment and retrieval. Mark Zero Prototypes was awarded for simplest deployment and retrieval with a $125,000 award and also received $20,000 for the second simplest assembly. And Project 816 was awarded $26,000 in the deployment and retrieval category, along with $9,000 in the assembly category. Moreover, each team was able to capture data and gain incredible insights to help advance these technologies and bring smaller scale wave power desalination closer to the communities that need them.
This is the first prize we've ever done that involved ocean testing. Most of our prizes have involved either tank testing or modeling or so on. So now that this prize is actually getting technologies in the water and the real world applications, you know, things come up that you just don't expect. And so certainly being able to do that fairly and work with the teams has certainly been a challenge, but we've managed to work through, I think, all of them.
There were some folks that said you can't deploy 4 wave energy converters in one day successfully, and we did that, right? And we all learned a whole lot from this process, and we have lots of ideas on how to move forward, and I think we're moving in that direction. And so in all, it was a success. We learned from our mistakes and we're moving forward, and we also are working better together as a team to do that.
These small scale applications build confidence, they build experience, so we can tackle new, bigger projects. So I think from an engineering standpoint, getting devices in the water, getting them tested, lessons learned, moving forward, has us better poised for the next big challenge in the ocean.
And the importance of the work started here in the Waves to Water Prize isn't lost on those involved.
The way we use water at this moment on this planet is simply not sustainable. And so we have to find ways to make it sustainable. And it's not a question of how or when, it's we have to.
I think wave energy and reducing carbon in the atmosphere are linked.
We are the long-term inhabitants of this planet. We need to think as such.
The reality is that as our world changes, as our climate changes, access to clean water is only going to become of increasing importance. And so it's going to take a multitude of different solutions to actually provide potable water. And what I'm excited about is that I think we're really demonstrating that wave energy can help be one of those energy sources to provide water to people who really need it.
We've done what we were trying to do with this prize. Now, with that being said, we're scratching the surface on wave power desalination. There's a whole lot of work that still needs to be done. There's a whole lot of research that we plan on doing at the labs, trying to get the whole community moving forward. And I would expect in the next decade or so that you'll see a lot of changes in the space.
I think we've shown the hypothetical, can you make water? Yes, now we have to figure out how we make these systems work longer, produce more water, and start to deliver results for whether it's disaster relief and recovery or small communities, but really, continuing the commercialization of these types of systems, continuing to have lessons learned. But I think that wave powered desalination is going to play a really meaningful role in providing clean water to communities worldwide. And I think this is a really good first step.
The work started here on the Waves to Water Prize can fuel future insights, advancements, and innovations across the marine energy sector, including the ability to bring drinkable water to those who need it. Find out more and check out current water power funding opportunities at energy.gov/water.